So welcome to all of you to the second session of a riser design. As you all know that in our previous session of a riser design, we look at some of the fundamentals and the concepts which are related to riser design, wherein we saw what is riser, why the riser is used, what are the things that we decide when we design a riser. So three things that we decide: one is the volume of riser, the second is a shape of a riser, and the third thing is a dimensions of a riser. And towards the end of a session, we saw classification of a riser, blind riser and open riser. And in open riser, it is further classified as a top riser and a side riser, right? So for a top riser and side riser, we established a relationship between D and H, so that the surface area of a riser is minimum, and so the solidification time of a riser is maximum, so that the riser can remain liquid for the longest period of time, so that it can serve and it can supply the liquid matter to the mold cavity or to the casting till the end of the solidification of a casting or a mold cavity, right? So that's what we saw in a previous class. In this session, we will be discussing about various methods of a riser design. But before we go to the various methods of riser design, here we want to derive very simple things. Let's say we want to derive a modulus of a various types of a riser. Why we want to do this? Because later on, when we will be looking at the methods of riser design, or when we will be solving some of the examples of riser design, at that time this derivations will become very handy to us. So that's why let's quickly derive the modulus for a top riser, side riser, let's say for us even spherical riser. We know that it is not practical to use, but what if it is asked somewhere? And let's say for a cubical riser as well. Okay, so let us first of all derive the modulus for a modulus of a top riser. Okay, what is a modulus? Modulus is nothing but a ratio of a volume to the surface area. So as you know, in a previous session we said that for a top riser, the relationship between D and H is going to be D is equal to 2 times H, or you can also write it as H is equal to D by 2. So we will be utilizing this particular relation in finding out the modulus. What is the volume of riser? Cylindrical riser it is. So the cylindrical riser has a volume of pi by 4 d square h. This is the volume. And what is the surface area? So here, when we talk about surface area, we are talking about that surface area which contributes to the heat transfer, which contributes to the heat dissipation. So as we have seen in a previous session, that the surface area of a top riser is going to be pi by 4 d square plus pi d h. Okay, so we want to find out the modulus in terms of, let's say, a diameter, and so we'll be replacing height by d by 2. So here, if we replace instead of h, if I write d by 2, it is going to be a pi by 8 d cube. Here it is going to be a pi by 4 d square, and here instead of h, if we write d by 2, it is going to be a pi by 2 d square. Okay, in order to further simplify, let us take pi by 4 d square common from numerator and denominator. So if we take pi by 4 d square common from top, we are left with d by 2. And here, if we take, let's say, pi by 4 d square common, then it is going to be a pi by 4 d square in bracket 1 plus, here pi by 2 d square is already there, so we have to multiply it by 2, or to simplify it, you multiply 2 with a numerator and 2 with a denominator. So it is going to be a 1 plus 2 here. So pi by 4 d square, pi by 4 d square gets cancelled. Here d by 2 and divided by 3. So this is d by 2 by 3 is nothing but a d by 6. So you can say that the modulus of a top riser is d by 6. Now, similar to this, let us try to find out what is the modulus of a side riser. So secondly, we want to find out what is a modulus of a side riser. Again, it is nothing but a volume upon surface area, right? Here, as we saw in a previous session, that we derived that for a side riser, the relationship between D and H is equal to D is equal to H. So volume is pi by 4 d square h Again, when we talk about surface area, which surface area we are talking about? We are talking about that surface area which is contributing to the heat transfer. So here the surface area is going to be 2 times pi by 4 d square plus pi d h, right? So here instead of h, if I write d, because we want, you know, modulus to be in terms of a d, so it is going to be a pi by 4 d cube divided by this 2 and 4 gets cancelled, so it is going to be a pi by 2 d square plus, here if I replace the h with d, it is going to be a pi d square. Again, if we take pi by 4 d square common from, let's say, a numerator, so then we are left with a d here divided by, here we have to multiply it with 2, because pi by 4 d square we are taking as a common, so here we have to multiply it with 2 plus, here we have to add 4, so pi by 4 is cancelled, pi by 4 d square is cancelled, d divided by 2 plus 4 d by 6. So again, modulus of a side riser is derived as a d by 6, while for a top riser also it was d by 6 only. Now let's say if we have a spherical riser, let's say, we know, we saw that to make a spherical riser is not practical and it also very difficult task. So, but let us, just for the sake of, because it might be asked in some numericals, so let us find out the modulus of a spherical riser. So spherical riser, again, nothing but a volume upon surface area. What is a volume of sphere? It is 4 by 3 pi r cube. And what is the surface area? Surface area of a sphere is nothing but a 4 pi r square. So this 4, 4 is cancelled, pi is cancelled, this r square, r cube is cancelled, so only r is left, so it is nothing but r by 3, and r is equal to nothing but a d by 2, so it is nothing but a d by 6. So modulus of a spherical riser turns out to be d by 6, okay? Now if we assume that we have a cubical riser, which means a riser which has a cubical shape. So, and if we assume that all the surfaces are contributing to the heat transfer, so in that case we want to find out the modulus of, let's say, a cubical riser. It is going to be volume upon surface area, right? So volume of a cube is nothing but a side of a cube is, let's say, a, so it is a cube divided by surface area, so it has a 6 faces, and so it is a 6a square. So again, a square, a cube, only a is left. So here you can say that the modulus of cube is also, again, nothing but a by 6, okay? So here these relations will become very handy to us when we'll do certain calculations in the future, or when we'll look at some of the methods of riser design, okay? Now here, see, it is with the given condition and whatever we know, we have derived this formula. Now, when you solve, you know, some of the numericals, in some of the numerical, it may happen that you have to derive the modulus of a riser as well, depending on the condition which is given into the numerical. So if there is no other condition which is given, then, you know, these formulas are going to work. But if there is any specific condition which is given into the numerical, in that case, you might have to recalculate what is going to be the modulus of riser, right? Okay. So kindly note this down, pause this video, it's very simple, you can also derive at your own. So we'll be utilizing this, you know, relations when we will look at, or when we'll see some of the methods of riser design. So totally we are going to look at the 4 methods of riser design, and 4 methods are: the first method is a Keynes method of riser design, second method is called as a modulus method, the third method is called as a naval research method, and the fourth method is called as a shrinkage volume consideration method. That's what we are going to do. So now let us look at this all methods one by one, and the first method is Kane's method of riser design. Okay. So in 1950s, Kane did extensive experimentation in order to decide the right size of a riser for a given casting. And on the basis of that extensive experimentation, he gave one formula with the help of which we are going to decide or we are going to design a riser. Now, that particular formula actually establishes a relationship between relative time of solidification of a riser to casting with a relative volume of riser and casting, right? What that formula is, see. So he gave a formula which says that X is equal to A divided by Y minus B plus C, where X is called as a freezing ratio, and this freezing ratio is nothing but a ratio of solidification time, or in a way you can relate it to the solidification because it is a ratio of a modulus of a riser and a casting. So we can say it is nothing but a ratio of a modulus of riser to modulus of casting, and modulus of any geometry is going to tell you that what is going to be its solidification time. So we can say that it's a ratio of a X represents a relative solidification time of a riser to a that of casting, right? So modulus of riser to modulus of casting, in few books it can also be written as like this: volume upon surface area of a riser to volume upon surface area of casting, right? Y is called as a volume ratio. It can also be called as a volumetric ratio, and it is nothing but a ratio of volume of riser to volume of casting, right? Here A, B, C, B and C, these three are constants. A is called as a freezing constant of a particular metal which we are casting. B is called as a contraction which takes place from liquid to solid, and C is called as a constant which depends on medium or a media which is surrounding the casting and the riser. So A, B and C are three constants, and three constants are known to us, they are given to us, right? So if you have any, if you will take any standard book of casting, you will find what is the value of A, B and C for steel, cast iron or aluminum. So that is always given to us when you want to find out the when we are designing a riser with the help of a Kane's method. So now let us see that how can we design it. So if I write, let's say, this in terms of this equation, in terms of these ratios, then it is going to be like this. X is nothing but MR upon MC is equal to A divided by Y is nothing but a volume of riser to volume of casting minus B plus C. So A, B and C are always known to us, right? You please focus here. Now, modulus of casting. See, when you are designing a riser, obviously we know what is the size of a casting, right? So if you know what is the size of a casting, we can find out what is a modulus of casting. From modulus of casting is nothing but, again, you can find out its volume of a casting and the surface area of a casting. So you can find out MC at your own. Volume of casting is also something we know because we know what is the size of a casting. Now, modulus of riser. Now, we just derived what is the modulus of a various riser, various type of riser. So top riser, side riser, cylindrical risers, and then a spherical and a cubical riser. So all of them have a same modulus as a D by 6. So let me write modulus of riser as a D by 6. MC is a mathematical, some mathematical value which we can find out or we know. A is something which we know. Now volume of riser. Now let's say that the volume of a let's say the riser that we are designing is a, let's say, cylindrical riser. So volume of riser is going to be how much? Pi by 4 d square h. Okay, now if you are designing a top riser, then d is equal to twice that of h, right? And if we are designing, let's say, side riser, then d is equal to h. So you can replace the h in terms of a d. Volume of casting, something a mathematical value, we definitely know. Minus b is always given to us for a particular method, and c is also something which we know. So in whole this formula, if you write h in terms of a d, the only thing that you did not know is a d, which is a diameter of a riser. And if you can find out a diameter of a riser, you can automatically find out the height of a riser. And so you know the shape of a riser, you know the volume of a riser, you know the dimensions of a riser, you have designed the riser. But with this method, the issue is, let's say when you write h in terms of a d, let's say you are designing a side riser, so d is equal to h. Let us just assume this. And so this is going to be a pi by 4 d cube. Now when you multiply this pi by 4 d cube with this d by 6, this d will come in terms of, let's say, d raised to 4. So your equation is going to be d raised to 4 plus something d raised d cube plus some d square or something like this. This is how you will get that kind of equation you will have. And we don't know any direct method to solve this particular equations where we have something of a power of, where we have a d with the power of 4, right? So in that case, what we need to do is that we have to solve this equation by trial and error method. And when we solve the trial and when we solve the equation with the, you know, by trial and error method, it becomes tedious, it becomes a very lengthy task. So this is one of the drawback of a Keynes method, that, you know, the task becomes lengthy, it becomes tedious. This is a drawback of a Keynes method. Otherwise, if we can solve this equation by trial and error method, we can definitely find out what is a diameter, and definitely we can find out what is the height of a riser. Now, Keynes, before he gave this equation, actually he gave one graph. And on his graph, on our x-axis, we have a freezing ratio, and on a y-axis we have this volume ratio. And his graph was something like this. This is just a representation of the freezing ratio. This is just a representation of a graph, just to explain you the methodology that he implemented. Let's see, this is one and this is two. So the graph that he gave was something like this. And you can see this graph in a book of a Amitava Ghosh and Ashok Malik. The name of a book is Manufacturing Science, written by these two professors. And it is published by East West Publication. So this graph is very much available. If you will just Google it, you will find this. So they say that the Keynes said that if your freezing ratio and your volume ratio, let's say, falls on the right hand side of this particular curve, if the combination of a volume ratio as well as a freezing ratio, let's say you just let's say we try to find out the ordinate, and this is a point, let's say we found this is a point which falls for our riser design, the riser that we designed, for which the freezing ratio is this much, and so the volume ratio is, let's say, going to be this much. If our point is here, if our point is anywhere on the right hand side of the curve, it means that we will be producing a sound casting, which means that the riser is going to perform well, it is going to feed the casting well, and so we will have a very good quality casting. But if the relation in the riser that we design, in which the relation falls on the left hand side of the curve, it means we are going to produce a poor quality casting, which means that the casting will not be of a good quality. This is something which is a finding of a Keynes, right? So this is how we can design the riser with the help of a Keynes method. You can note this down, you can pause the video and you can note this down, right? Now let us go to the second method of riser design, which is called as a modulus method of riser design. So modulus method of riser design, second is a modulus method of riser design. Here in this particular method is based on the Korinov's rule, and wherein he says that the solidification time is directly proportional to the modulus of a particular geometry. So here we say that in this method, if you want to design a riser by this method, we say that the modulus of riser, we know that the solidification time of a riser should be or must be greater than the solidification time of a casting. And so if it is so, then the modulus of riser should be greater than the modulus of casting. So we say that the modulus of riser should be greater than modulus of casting. But the question arises that how much greater than, you know. So according to this method, we say that the modulus of riser should be at least 1.2 times the modulus of casting, which means that the modulus of riser should be at least 20% greater than the modulus of casting. Now, if let's say we are designing a side riser, top riser, spherical riser, cubical riser, whatever, if my modulus of riser is V/6, in that case, this is going to be 1.2 times the modulus of casting, and so I can find out that the diameter of a riser is going to be 6 into 1.2, which is 7.2 times the modulus of casting. If it is a side riser, you know that D is equal to H. For top riser also, you know the relation. So if you can find out the D, you can also find out the H. So this is a very simple method of designing a riser, which is a modulus method. It's just that you need to know what is a modulus of casting. And definitely, if it's a straightaway equation, you know what is modulus of riser, it is D/6. If there is any other condition which is given to you, you have to derive what is going to be the modulus of a riser, right? So this is a modulus method, a very simple method of a riser design. Now let us look at the third method of riser design. The third method of riser design is called as a naval research method. And this method was developed around 1955 into the Naval Research Laboratory of a USA. So according to this method, what we need to do is that first of all, we have to find out the shape factor of casting. SFC stands for shape factor of casting. And shape factor of casting can be found by L plus W divided by T, where L is a length of casting, W is a width of casting, and T is a thickness of casting. So once we know what is the, you know, the shape factor of a casting, then the graph is readily available. Readily available graph is there. And if we look at, let's say, that particular graph, just a minute, I'll show you that graph. I'll draw the graph onto the board. So if the graph is readily available to us, wherein on x-axis we have a shape factor of casting, right? So shape factor of casting can be, let's say, some from 0 to some 16 or some 24 or let's say some 32. When we'll solve some of the examples, that at that time you will be able to see this. And here we have a ratio of volume of riser to volume of casting, which is, I also call it as a Y is equal to VR by VC. So every time, instead of writing VR by VC, I also write a Y. So that is given to us. Let's say this is 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8, and 1. So, and the relationship is something like this. So you know what is your shape factor of a casting. So if your shape factor of casting is, let us say, 24. So this is the point, and if this is the ordinate, then you go and see what is going to be the right ratio of a volume of a riser to volume of casting, and you know what is volume of what is the ratio. So once you know the ratio, let's say the ratio is 0.3. Let us assume that the ratio is 0.3. So VR upon VC, you found out SFC, which is 24. So the ratio Y is equal to VR upon VC, and the ratio turns out to be, let us say, 0.3. Then you know that VR is equal to 0.3 times VC. Volume of casting, do we know? Definitely we know, because we know the size of casting. So we know what is the volume of casting. What is the volume of riser? It is pi, cylindrical riser, obviously. Pi by 4 d square h is equal to 0.3 times VC. Now, if it is a top riser, you know the relationship between D and H. If it is side riser, you know the relationship between D and H. So you will be able to find out the D or H. Once you find out D, you can find out H. Once you know H, you can find out the D. So by this method, again, very simple method, by the interpreting the graph by interception, you know, of a points, we can find out what is a ratio of a VR to VC, and then very simply we can design the riser. In a examination, you may not be given a graph, let's say, readily. So in examination, you might be given, let's say, a table in which you are given one. On a one side, we have a shape factor of casting, and on the other side, you have a value of a VR upon VC, and similar values are given. So you find out what is the shape factor, and for that shape factor, what are the values. So you need to choose a value according to your shape factor, and you solve it the way I explained, right? So again, a very simple method. Now the question which comes in this particular method of a riser design is, let me just rub this and the question which comes is that what can be the shape factor for various geometries, and we'll discuss this for four geometries, four different type of shapes. Let's say first you have a very simple square, or let's say cubical, a cubical shape that we have. So let's say we have a casting which is of a size 50 by 25 by, let's say, 5. This is a size of a casting, right? So it is a plate, like this is a particular plate that we want to cast. So for this particular casting, if I want to find out the shape factor, it is L plus W divided by T. So here length is 50 plus width is 25, thickness is 575 by 5. You can easily find out what is the shape factor of casting, right? Now, second geometry, if let's say you are given a cylinder is given to us, for which its diameter is D and its length or height, whatever is given to us, is L. So in that case, the shape factor of a casting is going to be L plus W by T. So if it is L plus W by T, length is known to us. And for a cylinder, for a solid cylinder, its width is D as well as its thickness is also D only. So for a solid cylinder, your shape factor is going to be L plus D upon D. You know what is L and D, so you can find out it, right? Now let us say you are given a hollow cylinder. A hollow cylinder which has a third case is of a hollow cylinder. And for a hollow cylinder, the length is given to you. Let's say the internal diameter DI is given to you. The outer diameter DO is given to you, right? So if L, DI and DO is given to you, how will you find out the shape factor of casting? So shape factor of casting, again, nothing but L plus W divided by T. You know what is L, length is given to you. What is the width of a hollow cylinder? So if I want to find out, let's say, what is the length of a hollow cylinder, I can say that, let's say this is a hollow cylinder. Of course, bottle is a hollow cylinder, let us assume. And if I want to find out its width, what does it mean? I have to cut this bottle into half, and I have to open its two faces, like, and when whatever is going to be the width of that is going to be the width of a hollow cylinder. So what is the width of a hollow cylinder? The width of a hollow cylinder can be given by DI plus du divided by 2. And what is the thickness? Thickness is nothing, very simple. out minus di divided by 2, right? So this is how you can find out the shape factor of a hollow cylinder. And last but not the least, let's say for a sphere I want to find out what is the shape factor. For sphere, only dimension that we know is d. So shape factor of a sphere is going to be its length is d, its width is d, and its thickness is also d. So this is nothing but a 2, right? So this is how we can find out the shape factor for various shapes, and corresponding to that shape factor we can find out the ratio of VR to VC, and we'll be able to design a riser like this with the help of a naval research method. Again, a very simple method of a riser design. And now let us look at, again, you can note this down by pausing a video. I think it's good to have a notes with you so that whenever you are studying, it is going to be helpful. And whenever you will write something, I think it will stay in your mind for a longer period of time. I think how much time it stays in your mind is probably sometimes the least important, but whether you have understood the concepts or not is very important. And I hope you are able to understand what I am explaining. In case of any doubts, you can definitely write to me. I'll be solving your doubts. Right. So now we are going towards the last method of a riser design, which is called the fourth method. Shrinkage volume consideration method, right? Now if you remember, in a previous session, we said that the volume of shrinkage cavity should be volume of riser should be 3 times the volume of shrinkage cavity, right? So we are going to use this particular relation here, because we are, as the name of a method itself says, it is a shrinkage volume consideration. So whatever shrinkage is taking place, we are considering that volume in order to design a riser. So volume of riser, 3 times volume of shrinkage cavity. We know what is the volume of shrinkage cavity, right? We can find out volume of shrinkage cavity, as explained in a previous session, is nothing but a VC, which is the volume of casting, into A upon 100, where A is a percentage of a liquid shrinkage which is taking place during the process of solidification. Now from this we can find out what is the volume of riser. Now let's say if it is a top cylindrical riser, side cylindrical riser, even it's a spherical riser, whatever it is, pi by 4 d square h. If it is a top riser, you know the relation between d and h. If it is a side riser, you know the relationship between d and h. So similarly, you will be able to find out the d from here and h from here. Now when you design the riser with this particular method, there is one more thing that you need to check here. You know what is d and h. So if you know what is d and h, you can find out what is the modulus of riser, right? You can easily find out. Here the second thing that we need to check is that whether the solidification time of a riser is greater than or equal to, or greater than or equal to solidification time of a casting or not. So for this particular riser that we have designed, does this riser fulfill this condition as well? Because if this riser which we have designed does not fulfill this particular condition, then this design is of no use. This design is not acceptable to us. Because one condition which all the risers have to fulfill is that the solidification time of a riser must be greater than the solidification time of a casting. This is a condition that all the riser design has to fulfill. If the riser does not fulfill this particular condition, that that design cannot be acceptable to us, right? So we need to see whether this condition is fulfilled or not. So how we will do? Because we know the dimensions of a riser and dimensions of a casting, we will see whether the modulus of riser is greater than modulus of casting or not. If it is greater than, if the condition is fulfilled, then this design is accepted to us. But if this design, if this particular condition is not fulfilled, then we have to design a riser again by doing a reverse engineering. What if I want tau r to be greater than or equal to tau c? If it is so, then I want modulus of riser to be greater than modulus of casting. Right. So d by 6 must be greater than, let me write greater than or equal to, so that you know ultimately we are going to consider the equal to thing. D by 6 must be, I'm just considering d by 2, I'm just taking example for the simplification. D by 6 must be greater than or equal to modulus of casting, and so d must be greater than or equal to 6 times the modulus of casting. Right? Just for the, if I consider that the modulus of riser is d by 6. So we know what is the modulus of casting, and so we can find out, we can say that the d, because greater than, because we'll look at the minimum condition, so d should be at least 6 times the modulus of casting. So you can find out the d from this. This is going to be new diameter. If I denote this as d and h, I'll denote this new d and h as a d dash and h dash. If this condition is fulfilled, if this condition is not fulfilled, then you have to do the reverse engineering and you have to do this. And this is going to be the new dimensions of a riser. Now, the question which can come to your mind is that, sir, why do we need to take this particular route? Because when I find out the D and H from this, VR should be 3 times VSC, I have to check whether tau R is greater than or equal to tau C or not. And then if it is acceptable, it's good. If it is not, then I have to take this route. Though, why don't we take this particular route from a beginning itself? This is a question which can come to your mind. See, we need to understand one thing is that we don't want our riser to be undersized. We don't want our riser to be oversized. We want to design a adequate volume of riser, which has a adequate liquid metal, which will prevent the shrinkage cavity to happen into the casting, into the mold cavity. So if I take this particular route, I will be designing oversized riser. An oversizing of riser, which means that you are providing so much amount of a liquid metal to the riser, which will be of no use. And when you want to supply more amount of a liquid metal to a riser, you have to melt more amount of a liquid metal. And you, in order to melt more amount of a liquid metal, your furnace, you know, has to work for more amount of time. And furnace needs electrical energy, which means there is a lot of energy consumption which will take place if we do the over design of a riser. And when the more energy consumption takes place, more is the amount of money that you are going to spend. And more is the amount of money that you are going to spend, less is the less economical the process is going to be. So because this is not a making, this is a manufacturing process. And a manufacturing process has to be economical. This is something which we should be keeping in our mind. And that's why we will not take this route first. We will take this route. We'll check the condition. If not satisfied, then we will take this route. We will not take this route directly. I hope you understood this. And I hope you understood all the four methods of a riser design. Here I want to, you know, introduce you to one term. It just comes to my mind. And the term is called as a casting yield. And casting yield, let's say the casting yield is a 50%. This term, what is the meaning of casting yield? Let me explain that to you. If casting yield is a 50%, it means that you supplied 100 kilogram of liquid metal. You supplied 100 kilogram of liquid metal, and out of that 100 kilogram, when you are done with, you know, the solidification process and fettling process and cutting of a riser and runner and all, you got actual component of a 50 kilogram. So in order to get the solidified component of a 50 kilogram, you poured 100 kilogram of a liquid metal. So remaining 50% is not lost. Someone has not stolen it. But then it is solidified. It is solidified into the riser. It has solidified into the runner, ingates, and in a sprue. And so you have to cut the runner and a sprue. Sorry, runner and riser, and then you will be remelting it. So melting and remelting, it consumes a lot of energy. So if I want to, let's say, define casting yield in terms of ratio, I'll say this that it is a actual weight of component divided by weight of liquid metal supplied into 100. Instead of weight, you can use the term mass as well. Does not make a difference. GG is cancelled, right? So actual mass of a component that you made, and a weight or mass of a total liquid metal that we supplied. We always want to have a casting process which has maximum casting yield. We always want to have a process which has a maximum casting yield. And so if you want to have a maximum casting yield, you cannot be designing a riser which is oversized. We always have to design a riser which has adequate amount of a liquid metal, which should have optimum amount of a liquid metal. The optimum is the correct word to use here. It should have optimum amount of a liquid metal in order to supply it to the mold cavity or to the casting, so that the shrinkage cavity can be avoided, right? So I hope you understood what I explained in this session, whatever we discussed in this session. In case of any doubts, please write to me, and thank you very much for joining. Thank you.